for $1? Any idea? Any one of you? Can you quickly tell me? Kamalakshi, are you present today? Tanuja and Kamalakshi. Can anyone tell me exchange rate between UAE dirham and US dollar?
Sir.
Lalita? Yeah.
One UAE dollar equals 0.27 United States dollar, sir. Sorry, one UAE dinam equals 0.27 US dollar, sir.
Correct. Perfect. Then $1 is equal to how many dirhams, Lalita?
3.67.
Thank you. Thanks, Ravi and Pavan. That's good. Very good.
Yes.
So now, my question to you is, any guess? Indian rupee against dollar exchange rate is $1 is 73.74 rupees. $1 is equal to 3.67 dirhams. So why or who fixes these exchange rates? Any guess? Any idea? Who does this? How the exchange rates are fixed?
Sir, it's London
sir,
Bank.
Guess.
Yeah, go on, Pawan.
World Bank, sir. It's World Bank.
Yeah. Yeah, go on, Pawan.
Sir, it's World Bank in London.
Sorry?
World Bank, sir.
World Bank? Okay. Lalita, you're saying something?
Sir, I guess exchange rate is fixed by exports and imports of a country, sir.
Export and importing companies? Okay. For the time being, I'll take it. Anyone else?
So RBI.
Sorry?
RBI.
RBI.
Who is it? I can't see you. Please turn your videos on whenever you're responding.
Sir, RBI.
Sorry, RBI?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. Anyone else? Good. These are good guesses. I happily take these guesses and take the forward. Take the session forward. Okay. Now, exchange rate can be fixed by central bank of a country, that is RBI, as you said. Exchange rate should be based on imports and exports between two countries. We can take that also. But World Bank doesn't intervene in two countries' exchange rates. Okay, that I can say that. Let us look at Indian context. Till reforms. Economic reforms in early 90s, Indian rupee was exchanged with basket of currencies, US dollar, sterling pound, French franc, German mark. Okay, the exchange rate of Indian rupee with these basket of currencies was fixed, was pegged by RBI. For example, Indian rupee versus dollar was 16 rupees, $1 was the exchange rate. For many years, it was. Then later, RBI itself changed the exchange rate to 28 rupees in 1991. Further, it has changed it to 32 rupees. And it was more popular as devaluation of rupee. Whether it is devaluation at 32 or 28 or fixed earlier, at 16, it is fixed exchange rate. Fixed by whom?
RBI, sir.
RBI. Okay. But later on, the early 90s, slowly the market got opened. RBI let the dollar open to market, let exporters and importers, demand and supply, buyer and sellers of dollars, let them fix the exchange rate. Okay, so even now today we have market based, open market based exchange rate system. So yesterday Jagadish told me 73.74 rupees per dollar is the exchange rate. Can any one of you tell me what is the exchange rate right now? $1 is equal to or is how many rupees?
73.55.
Yesterday it was 73.74. Today it is, right now it is 73.55. So you can see this change. Exchange rate has come down. It means rupee value appreciated. Okay. Dollar value depreciated. Okay. So our topic today is exchange rate determination. So in our example, I clearly told you that RBI used to fix exchange rate earlier, but now market is determining the exchange rates. So probably there are two methods of arriving at exchange rate: fixed exchange rate by central banks or government bodies, and flexible exchange rate, which is changing. Okay. Why I took the example of UAE dirham and dollar, and dollar and Indian rupee, and you also gave me the exchange rates, 73.55. Am I right? Who said that?
Yes, sir.
Who said that?
Sai Karan.
Please, sir, turn your video on when you respond to me. Yeah. 73. How much?
55, sir.
55. So Indian dollar versus rupee is 73.55. Okay. Yesterday it was 73.74. It is changing because it is determined by market. Whereas in the case of UAE dirham and dollar, it is pegged or fixed. It will not change. That is the understanding between the two countries because of oil transactions or oil trade. That is the condition they had. Okay. So with UAE and dollar, UAE dirham and dollar, it is fixed standard. But with Indian rupee and dollar, it is volatile. Okay. So which one would you say it is better? Can any one of you tell me? Would you go for fixed exchange rate, or would you suggest flexible or volatile or changing exchange rate? Which one do you say? Who says fixed exchange rate is better? Who says flexible or market rate exchange rate is better?
So market rate.
Market rate. I can't see you. Who is that? Six. Asha. Okay. Asha says market rate. Anyone else?
Market rate only, sir.
Pavan is also saying market. Okay, good. Others?
Flexible. Market rate only, sir.
Market rate only. Everyone is saying market rate.
So based on the situations, I mean.
Can you give me a situation? You can take any situation. That's right. You are right.
So for doing trade, when the exchange rate is more than market rate, we choose market rate over that, sir.
Correct. Yeah. See, as a student, you are not associated with any foreign exchange rate reserve. So as a student, you are saying, you visualize yourself as an RBI. You are the RBI governor. Yeah. You are the finance minister. You are the prime minister of India. Okay. You are an exporter. Okay. You are an importer. You are a traveler from India. You want to go out. So you want dollars. Say you are a student. You want to go for higher studies. You want to, after your master's, you want to do a PhD in US or UK. So in that way, if you look at in different dimensions, views will change. Okay, so fixed exchange rate differently is not a good idea, because it is the government or central bank which dictates the terms. I agree, but market rate is also a problem in the times where the whole world is dying for foreign currency reserve. More than, I think in the first session we discussed, I think I remember Radha, today she's absent. Radha was talking about foreign currency reserves. Everyone is looking for US dollars or euro dollars or sterling pound or gold reserves as a reserve to create global or international liquidity. So for that, in our country, we may try to get dollars for global dominance. Okay, so there are many interventions and factors here. Okay, so as I forgot his name, what's your name? You said it depends on the situation.
Sir Rakesh.
Yeah, Rakesh Kalyan. He said that it depends on the situation. So what is your situation? Are you an exporter? Are you an importer? If you are an exporter, you love to see exchange rate going up. You love to see increase in demand for dollar or euro dollar, US dollar or euro dollar sterling pound. If you're an importer, whenever exchange rate goes up, your heart pumping rate goes up, increases. Yes or no? Right? So it depends on what you are. If you want to travel, you want more dollars. You are planning to travel next year after COVID gets settled, vaccine comes in. Okay? So you want to accumulate dollar now itself. But in the future, if it goes up, you're happy. In future, if it comes down, you feel bad. So these kind of situations will make you whether it should be market or fixed. It all depends. Even political factors will be there. Economic factors, of course. We are talking about international finance in economic context. Social problems will be there. Country to country relationship we have to understand. MOUs will be there, most favored nation status we have to consider, MFN status, different things are there. Okay, so if you consider market as the base to arrive at the exchange rate, that depends on demand for foreign currency and supply of foreign currency. Okay, how do you see RBI? In 40 rupees, it was around 40 rupees in 2008. Okay, because of the global recession till 2009, the 40 to 43 rupees exchange rate has come down to 30s. It slipped to 41, 40, 39, 38. It came down till 34, 33, if I'm not wrong. Okay, then later, RBI came into the market. Okay, you called as sterilized market interventions. Okay, RBI, though it is not fixing the exchange rate, it is not a fixed exchange rate regime, it is over. We have a flexible exchange rate now. But still, RBI, government, prime minister, finance minister, they closely watch exchange rate. They have a clear idea whether it has to go up or come down. When exchange rate of Indian rupee versus dollar came down from 43-44 levels to 33-34, I personally thought this is the end of software industry in India, because the whole income comes to software companies through exports of services. Okay. But when the exchange rates have come down so drastically, they will be in heavy losses. But RBI came to the rescue. They pumped a lot of rupees. I mean, they bought dollar heavily and created demand. They increased the demand so that it could stabilize. So then it got stabilized to 43. And later on, it moved to 50s quickly, then 60s, then 70s. We are in 70s right now. Okay, so this is all market made. So importers, exporters, foreign investors through FDI, foreign investors through FPI, foreign portfolio investors. So whenever they go out, they want the dollars. Okay. Whenever they come in, they increase the supply of dollars. Whenever they go back, they create demand because they want to take back dollars along with them. So these kind of dynamics make our Indian rupee appreciated or depreciated. Okay. When our foreign trade, for the first time in the history of Indian trade, in the first quarter of 2020, India had a surplus balance of trade. I think we discussed that in the last class also. So not just the trade, we need to look at the other inflows also, other outflows also. Then only we can say exchange rate trends would go down or go up. Kind of. Fine. So this is how exchange rate is fixed. Okay. Earlier we discussed about interest rate parity theory, inflation parity theory, or purchasing power parity theory. So exchange rate determination is also tied up with those factors, not just trade demand or investment demand and so on. That is also considered, but that you cannot quantify immediately. They are not direct. So in that case, what happens is inflation rate is too high in India. Definitely it will depreciate against any foreign currency. Inflation rate is good now, it is single digit, then we cannot consider purchasing power parity or inflation as a criteria to consider exchange rate system. There is something called rear and near, R-E-E-R, rear, near, N-E-E-R. Near, or I think it's more than near. I think the subtitles itself is correcting me. It's near or rear. What does it stand for? Rear stands for real effective exchange rate. Real effective exchange rate. Near stands for nominal effective exchange rate. What are these two? When Indian rupee is 73 rupees 55 paisa against $1, it has to be adjusted. It has to be adjusted with inflation. But in India, it's not a big issue because inflation is nominal. It is not that sensitive now. But if you look at other countries like Zimbabwe, I think it is a popular example for inflation, with inflation tendencies. I think any country, prima facie, they will look at inflation first. Then they will look at other economic, political, social, cultural, trade, investment factors. Okay. So when you look at inflation and interest rate, if it is adjusted, it is real. Real effective exchange rate. Maybe sometimes inflation is not adjusted. If it is ignored, then you consider, you call it as near. It happens with the fixed exchange rate or pegged exchange rates, where near can be understood. It is because inflation is changing, but exchange rate is fixed. Exchange rate is fixed. Inflation rate is changing. So it is not rear. It is what?
Near, sir.
It is near. It is nominal effective exchange rate, which means it has ignored inflation. It is not rear. It is near. Okay. That's good. So now we are clear. Exchange rate, fixed exchange rate, flexible exchange rate, factors influencing exchange rate, primarily demand and supply, then factors affecting demand, importers, importers are demand side or supply side? They need dollars or importers give dollars?
Give dollars.
Give dollars, sir.
They have to give dollars to buy, right? So they demand, they need dollars. Okay? Importers,
yes, sir,
are on demand side of foreign currency. Exporters?
Supply side,
obviously. So once you're clear with this, that is clear. So when you sell your product out of the country, then you get dollars. Your dollars are ready in your hand. You can't use foreign currency everywhere. And what you do? You convert that into rupee and use your money. Okay. So you exporter is in supply side of the dollar. You got the difference, my dear friends?
Yes, sir. Good.
So foreign investors coming to India, demand side or supply side?
Supply.
Very good. Market crashed in India due to some policy of finance minister and they're leaving India. So it is for foreign investors, demand side or supply side?
Demand.
They're leaving India. They want their money back. Okay. Mukesh Ambani bought a telecom major in Brazil. Is it demand side or supply side?
Demand, sir.
Demand side, because he is buying the foreign company, so has to pay in dollars. So he needs money. Okay. Indian government has taken through ADB, Asian Development Bank, worth of $1 billion. To support national highways in India. It took the loan. Demand side or supply side?
Demand, sir.
Demand? It has taken the loan. Means dollars are coming to India. So supply side.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So this way, whatever may be the reason, as Rakesh told, it all depends on the situation. It is a situation which is important to you. Whether an exporter is making money, making profits or not, that is irrelevant. He is getting dollars to India. Importer is giving dollars out of the country. So this way, dollar inflow and outflow makes the exchange rate volatile. Okay. And did you get the logic, all of you, my dear friends?
Yes, sir.
Now you tell me, anyone, you like to see fixed exchange rate or flexible exchange rate in India? Which one would you say? You can say anything, but justify it.
Sir, flexible, sir.
Why, Pavan?
Sir, because our imports and exports, based on our imports and exports and foreign currency reserves in our India, it is less. Our rupees compared to dollar is very less, sir. When it is raised, our rupee value is raised, then we can fix it. In that way, it is useful for us, sir. Even though if we fixed the exchange rate, we cannot compare with the dollar and we cannot increase the economy. Yes, sir.
Okay. Good response. Others? Anyone else?
Flexible exchange rate only, sir.
Only. Okay. Why you are saying flexible exchange rate, Lalita?
to increase our foreign reserves, sir.
Flexible, okay, you have given a good point. So flexible exchange rate increases foreign reserves. Okay. Rakesh, Kalyan, what do you say? Earlier you gave it depends, but now what do you say? We are clear.
We can say that this one is better, that one is better. Flexible exchange rate is better when compared to fixed exchange rate. But when coming to when there is more importance, more imports in the country, we need to go with the RBI fixing. We need to go with the fixed exchange rate, sir. When there is
very diplomatic, neither this side nor that side. He is justifying both. Good, good. That is a very good justification also. Thank you, Rakesh. Okay. Fine. See, Lalita has given a point and someone else has given some other point. Increasing the foreign currency reserves, okay? Showing the dominance, Pawan was saying that those things have different implications. They have to be strategized in different dimensions, okay? But prima facie, looking at the economy, GDP, trade deficit, balance of payment, balance of trade, FDIs, FAs, and everything, I think anyone would love to see exchange rate mechanism. Okay. We have foreign exchange risk exposure and other things and its risk management. In other units, we'll discuss that. Okay. Even if you're feeling that you are in a volatile situation, you are risky, if it is flexible exchange rate, there are some measures to protect them. Apart from that, exchange rate with a market determined rate is always a healthy situation, because no one can dominate, neither RBI nor importers, the other way exporters, investors, no single stakeholders in foreign currency exchange. No one can dominate the market. So that makes the market democratic. It is transparent. Okay, no one can control. That way, foreign exchange rate is always good with the flexible exchange rate. So I also agree with you all. That's a good thing. Okay, maybe I'll just introduce one thing called arbitrage. Can anyone you, I think in financial markets and services, you might have got this. Trader, hedger, investor, arbitrager, or simply trade, invest, arbitrage, hedge. Can anyone differentiate these things? I repeat, trading, investing, hedging, arbitraging. Any difference, anyone? Have you heard about this? You can share if you have heard about this. Jagdish is missing today, right? He was asking about traders and hedgers earlier. I told him we will discuss in a different session. No one? Say something here. Anyone?
Sir, good morning, sir. I'm there, sir.
Yeah, why you're not responding, Jagdish? Say something. You got the question, right?
Sir, sir.
Sai Priya, I want to see Sai Priya respond in this session. Sai Priya is showing a Siberia here. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Sai Priya, are you there? Okay. Let me tell you. Trading is just for quick profits, quick money. You do intraday trading or trading for short term, buy today, sell tomorrow, BTST, it is more popular in India, or trade for 1 week kind of thing. But you don't look beyond that. Maybe sometimes a month or few months, not beyond that. That is how you can look at a trader. Investor is not like that. Investor's objective is to love that investment avenue. He or she loves that investment avenue. Let it be real estate, equity, gold, a bond, or anything. They love to invest, and they do a lot of analysis on that, fundamental analysis, technical analysis. You know, I think in your security analysis and portfolio management, you have done that, or you'll be doing that in the coming sessions. So you do a lot of homework on that. What kind of a company is that? You learn CAPM model, you know, performance evaluation methods. You learn all those things. That is investment. Then hedging is a risk management tool. We'll discuss that in foreign currency derivatives. Then arbitrages. In arbitrage, when I was young, what I used to do is, I used to buy shares in Vizag market, okay? Andhra Petro, I forgot the names also. NFCL, Nagarjuna Fertilizers Limited, NFCL kind of companies. DCM, I believe. I used to have a portfolio of 5 to 10 stocks. I used to closely follow them. Buy here in Vizag, sell in Vijayawada. Buy in Vijayawada, I used to physically travel with my friends. Buy in Vijayawada, sell in Vizag. Company is the same, shares are the same, price is different in different markets. Okay? That you call it as arbitrage. Even now also, may I know the price? Today market is holiday, I believe. Okay, stock markets, holiday. Any idea what is the price of Reliance Industries? Anyone? Huh? 1900 plus? Can anyone help me? You're following that. Huh?
Sir, 1992.95, sir.
1992.95, sir. 1992. So close to 2000 rupees. Okay. So yes. If it is the price in NSE, 1992.56 is the price in NSE. And in BSE, it is 1995.05. So what do? It is an arbitrage opportunity. What do you mean by that? Buy in NSE for 92, sell in BSE for 93. It's a great arbitrage opportunity. Did you understand all of you? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Did you understand the example?
Yes, sir.
1992.95 is Reliance Industries Limited in NSE. 1993.75 in BSE. It is an arbitrage opportunity. I'm saying, why it is an arbitrage opportunity to make money? You buy for 92.95 in NSE and sell that same quickly in BSE for 1993.75. So you make a profit of some 79 paise. Okay. Why 83 paise? Am I right? Are you following me?
Yes, sir.
How much? 92 minus 75. 77 paise is the profit, am I right? No? 1992.95 minus 1993.75. What is the difference?
Sir, in points you can't.
Sir, 80 paisa, sir.
80 paisa is the profit.
Yes, sir, 80 paisa.
Hello, all of you. Are you there? Lalita, Sai Priya, Asha, Rakesh.
Yes, sir, 80 paisa is the profit.
How much is the profit?
80 paisa is the profit.
Meghna?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, 80 paisa is the profit, but you have to consider stamp duty, brokerage, all these things, STT, securities transaction tax, everything. After that, still if you have profit, so for example, brokerage is 30 paisa, stamp duty and other things, everything included, 40 paisa is the cost. So still 80 paisa minus 40 paisa. 40 paisa is the profit to you because Zerodha is charging only 30 paisa and now it has brought it down. It is just 20 or 25 paisa. Upstox is offering for 20 paisa. Okay, so when you deduct all these things, still you are at profit. Did you understand?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. So buying in one market. Yes, selling in another market for profit, you call it as arbitrage. It is a kind of trade, but not in the same market. Trading for different prices. In trading, you buy at high price, low price, and sell it for high price, profit. Or sell it for high price, buy it for low price, profit. That is trading. Okay? Investment means you buy it today, you hold it, you look for dividends, you look for monthly or annual returns, and you look for capital appreciation. That is investment. There is arbitrage because of the price differential. In one market, it is low. In another market, it is high. So what you do? You sell here, buy here. Or you buy here and you sell here. That's it. You make profit. This is arbitrage. Okay. I think there is something called triangular arbitrage in Forex market. So that's the reason I introduced you this today. In the next session, we'll be talking about arbitrage. That is next week, Monday, not Monday, Wednesday, first session. Okay. So any questions? Are the things clear, all of you?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Any question? Anyone has? Jagdish, Rakesh. Pavan,
no,
Lalita, Meghna.
No, sir.
No, sir.
So if there are no questions, no. We'll wind up for today. Thank you all for your participation. See you on Wednesday next week. Thank you all. Happy holiday.
Thank you, bye-bye. Sir.
Thank you, 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 sir.